like the most previous video on this channel, you can debate that this video's topic is a lot of duh, like, of course, that's how it is, Lego. Why do you have to make a video about this? It's not really surprising to hear this. And I get it. I get it. You probably already knew this, but because it's come out in probably the most unlikely of sources, from one of the more unlikely guys you would expect to reveal this, and because it's such a funny story to talk about, I decided, hey, let's set aside a few minutes over here, I got some gameplay lying around, and let's talk about how the Buffalo Sabres were indeed tanking for Connor McDavid in 2014-15. Now, the reason we're talking about this specifically is because on TSN's Instagram page, they ended up posting a snippet of what is going to be their Ted Nolan documentary. Take a look at this. Former NHL Coach of the Year Ted Nolan remains separated from league's exclusive coach fraternity. Nolan explains why he believes he's still on the outside looking in. Watch the TSN original, The Unwanted Visitor, this Friday night on SportsCenter. So there you go, TSN, there's your plug. This video is a snippet of that interview, documentary, original, whatever. And if you know who Ted Nolan is, you know that he was somewhat of a pretty successful, might I say relatively successful coach in the NHL compared to other coaches. He didn't coach in the NHL for long, but he was here making the conference semifinals and the quarterfinals two straight coaching years in a row. And I say two straight coaching years in a row because those two coaching years were a decade apart. He took some time off. He took a lot of time off, actually, between the Sabres, the Islanders, and eventually the Sabres. With the Buffalo Sabres in 2014-15, he was the head coach that led this team to 82 games played, 23 wins, 51 regulation losses, and 8 overtime losses. So, a total of 54 points. They were last in the NHL. They didn't win the draft lottery because the draft lottery back then, instead of having the 1-2-3 lottery system, it was just the one system where the first overall pick would be decided by lottery. So, because it was Edmonton who won that draft lottery that year, Buffalo dropped from first to second, and they selected Jack Eichel. Okay, cool, that's the story. We all kind of recognize that the Sabres in 2015 were not really doing all too great in terms of being able to actually play. They stunk. They were really bad, and a lot of people would tout a lot of the matchups between the last few teams in the NHL as really important matchups. For example, I remember there was a game between the Oilers and the Leafs, two teams at the bottom of the standings, but who were not at Buffalo's tier of being last, and Leafs fans said that the matchup between these two teams in that season was called the Jack-Off, because the loser would go on to win Jack Eichel in the draft, and the winner would end up, I don't know, doing other things, getting Mitch Marner in the draft, I guess. But that's kind of how competitive things were in 2014-15, because Connor McDavid was just this astronomically amazing player in the OHL, and everybody was like, yeah, he's going to be in the NHL right away, he's going to do great things. But for the Buffalo Sabres, everybody kind of knew that this team was just so bad that they kind of wanted to lose. And I say they, I'm referring to the coaching staff, the management, and the people behind the organization, not necessarily the players on the ice themselves. Because if you go over to this TSN video with Ted Nolan, sorry for the very long tangent, by the way, I just wanted to get all that context out. One of the top comments over here on this TSN Instagram post is from Matt Hackett. Now, if you remember, Matt Hackett was an NHL goaltender who was indeed playing for the Sabres in the organization from 2013 up until 2015. He played 5 games with the Sabres in that season. He had a 4.32 goals against average and an 8.84 save percentage, and he was 0-4-1. This is what he said in the comments of that Instagram post. 100% we tried to lose. They brought half our team up from the American League and put me in net, coming off a torn ACL, not even close to NHL ready. Teddy was one of the best, and he gives off the little, like, hand radical sign, sarcastically, of course. So Matt Hackett is coming out here and just being super genuine, like, yeah, we really weren't put in a great position to succeed. It was not me, it was not the players out there. We didn't intentionally try to lose. You never do that if you're a hockey player. You don't go out there with the intention of being bad. But the team around you, the general managers, the organization, the coach, they can certainly set things up to make it a lot more difficult for the players on the ice to win. I can't even begin to imagine how it must feel being in that situation. This comment from Matt Hackett, pretty much confirming that the Sabres were trying to tank for Connor McDavid, was posted onto the Sabres subreddit, and some of the comments over here are really funny. One of them said this, and it was actually kind of eye-catching to me. He says, "Pretty sure this stopped being a conspiracy theory when Brian Gionta got booed for scoring against Arizona at home." And I was like, okay, I need to look at this right here, because the Arizona Coyotes back in that season were one of the worst teams in the NHL too. They finished second last in the standings behind the Buffalo Sabres, who of course were last. Arizona finished with a total of, and you're not going to believe this, 56 points, and the Sabres finished with 54. So it was just a 2-point difference between Arizona and Buffalo. And if you go by what was the overall draft rankings, etc., because Edmonton won the first overall pick, second overall belonged to the worst team in the league, Buffalo, third overall was Arizona, Dylan Strome. Had things gone just a little bit differently for either of these teams, Arizona would have Jack Eichel. So think about that for a sec. There was a game in March of 2015, before the season's end, where Phoenix? I don't know what it was called back then. They were playing Buffalo in Buffalo. And I actually had to look this up. This is incredibly funny. Heading into the third period, the score was 3-2 Arizona. Ekman Larson had a goal, Dave Moss had a goal, Jordan Suarez had a goal as well. And in the third period, with 3 minutes left in the game, who does it on the power play? It's Brian Gionta. He comes in, he scores a power play goal, he just grips it and rips it, and it's in the back of the net. When this happened, you could see a very visible part of the fan base, because remember, there are fans in the stands at this time, actually go up in shock. Buffalo Sabres fans wearing Sabres jerseys facepalm. You could see it in the video. Some of these guys are legitimately like, oh no, because they tied the game against a team in the Arizona Coyotes that was so close to Buffalo in the standings, and Sabres fans wanted to separate that gap and give Arizona the 2 points. This game ended up going to overtime, and the Arizona Coyotes won in overtime. And after the Coyotes score, it's Sam Gagne who grips it and rips it on the power play. You can see the whole fan base in Buffalo. There are a whole bunch of yellow and white jerseys that stand up with their hands in the air. And the big, yeah, chant is so loud, it's almost like the Sabres fans wanted to lose. I'll leave a link to the video in the description. You can see several of the Sabres fans in the crowd legitimately cheering that their team lost in overtime because the stakes of Connor McDavid, Jack Eichel, Dylan Strome, who was the consensus third overall prospect back then, were so grand that everybody was like, okay, we need to lose this game. Like, we cannot afford to get any points here from Arizona and keep them from getting any points. Remember, the gap between these two teams was 2 points at the end of the season. And had things gone the way that they had, but the teams were swapped, we would have seen Dylan Strome go to Buffalo instead. Remember, Dylan Strome was not really seen as a bum back then. He was really highly touted as the best player in the OHL, one of, behind Connor McDavid, and it wasn't even really close. He was so good, so dominant. McDavid was out for a good portion of the year, I think because he hurt his hand in the fight. But with McDavid gone, it was Dylan Strome's time to shine, and he really showed himself off as a top prospect. In my opinion, just based off of the rhetoric going around the NHL at that time frame, I don't believe the Sabres would have gone with Marner. I believe they probably would have gone with the guy that people thought would have gone third overall in Dylan Strome. So, how things could have been different there. If Jack Eichel got sent over to Arizona, I don't know how much happier he would be if things went down that way and the rest of the players and the organization stayed the way they were. I don't know. It's kind of weird to think about, right? But at the end of the day, it's actually Matt Hackett over here who's confirming, yeah, the Buffalo Sabres were tanking for McDavid, and even if they didn't get McDavid, remember, this draft lottery format only had one lottery done, not three. So if you're last in the league, you're guaranteed at least Jack Eichel. And if you won that draft lottery, which you had a very good chance of doing so, you would get McDavid instead, which a lot of people were expecting, but of course Edmonton had to come in and swoop in and ruin all the fun for everybody once again, and now Connor McDavid is the best player in the world on Edmonton. But with that being established, let me know in the comments what you thought about this weird video topic. I know it's a weird dive into history, but I just thought it would be so interesting to talk about this story again, just because it was already revealed that yes, the Sabres were pretty much doing their best to ice the worst product they could out there. So much to the point that they were so bad that all the fans in their arena were starting to boo when Brian Gionta, their captain, scored the game-tying goal with 3 minutes left in the third. Yeah, fans were booing at that. Tell me in the comments what you think. I hope you enjoyed this bit of Trolls 99. And bye.